Hello, I am Christopher Miguel Gomez, and today I will be presenting Gene Toomer. Gene Toomer, a man who saw himself beyond the constraints of society's racial boundaries and conformities. Throughout his life, he wavered between the ideas of what it meant to be black in a white world, though he ultimately neglected to accept his blackness. Born in Washington, D.C., December 26, 1894, to the first black governor of Louisiana, Nathan Toomer. Unfortunately, a year after Gene's birth, his father abandoned him to move back to his hometown of Mason, Georgia. His mother was so distraught that she moved back to Washington, D.C. with her father, and he was very much infuriated. He would not let them stay unless Gene's name was changed. This is why he is now Gene Toomer instead of Nathan Pinchback. This led to an opportunity for Toomer to later on in his life be able to reinvent his self-image after high school. However, his adolescent schooling was not the most fortunate for him. Gene was a great mixture in his genetics. He had a little bit of everything. He descended from Dutch, French, Native American, German, Welsh, Jewish, and was of African American descent. However, because of his unique combination of genes, he was considered to be white passing. And this did not fare well for him in his adolescence. During his stay in Washington, during high school, he underwent a lot of bullying for his skin color in both the all-white schools, but mostly in the all-black schools. His peers often saw him as an outlier in their society in which he was not considered to be of the same blackness as his fellow brothers and sisters. After high school, he acknowledged his beliefs that lie beyond the ideas of race, and accepted that we as a culture could be unified beyond the racial boundaries. He decided that he was going to align with the idea that he did not conform to any racial titles and saw himself beyond so, in which he did not consider himself a part of the black society. Toomer spent a large sum of his life walking between the lines of race and finding his own avenue. And through his very popular work, Kane, he strived to come to understand his true blackness. Historians proudly represent his great work of Cain to be one of the initial sparks of the Harlem Renaissance. He then led this to be the motif of his writing further on in his career. Unfortunately for Toomer, this led to him entirely neglecting his blackness and denouncing it from his persona entirely. He did not see himself as a black man, though of course, deep down, he knew that he was. Gene used the advantages of his white passing skin tone to accelerate this belief within himself. Later into his college years, around 1919, Gene met a man named Waldo Frank while he worked at a publishing agency. While at the publishing agency, Frank helped Toomer get his literary work published, which later brought him to his most renowned piece of literature. In 1923, Gene Toomer released Cain into the world, which unraveled the complexities of this writer's deepest ideologies. Composed of both poetry and prose, Cain at the time of its release was an experimental piece for the literature world, in which it was written in a way that was lyrical as well as it was poetic. It was as much as a story as any tale, and as much as a poem as any sonnet. Cain was a piece of work that truly illuminated the differing experiences of black life in America, while shedding light on those that were unheard and unacknowledged. Cain was and still is a controversial piece of work, not only for its content, but as well for its writer. Toomer, for the rest of his life after writing this piece, rejected the black side of it and constantly denounced the cultural importance of this writing. He envisioned a world in which the importance of race did not exist and where culturally we could unify against our differences. This amazing piece of literature provides a different perspective on Southern black life in America that encompasses the true struggle of blackness. Cain allows us to think between the space of racial divide, in which we see a rhythm of American literature from characters that could exist nowhere else in this world. Personally, through my own read of Cain, I found great relation to the content and how Georgia is today. The prose poem, Becky, really struck a chord with me. The main character, who is a white single mother with one white child and one Negro child. Unfortunately for her, she was treated horribly and described in a way that gave the impression of her poverty and famishedness. In the story, along the railroad, the workers would throw leftover scraps and crumpled slips scribbled with prayers. People throughout the town gave her portions of food unknowingly to her. Throughout the poem, Becky is acknowledged as dead or had already been dead by her lack of presence within her children's life. Even as I grew, the town folk questioned if she was even alive. Personally, I see a parallelism between the content of this story and the relationship between African Americans and how the rest of society has treated them in the past and currently. When considering the time in which Cain was released, if you were black, you were given the bare minimum. And this also applies to the white people who had sympathy for black people. They were treated with the same disregard. Toomer uses the ability of his poetic prose to describe the true conditions of the treatment of black people in the South. Digging deeper and looking at the setting of the train yard and the workers who would give her the scraps resonated a lot with me. In Savannah, Georgia, where I currently reside, there are certain areas around the train yard where the living conditions are extremely impoverished. Given that Toomer referenced Cain off of his trip to Georgia around the 1920s, truly shows how much the state has really changed throughout history. Obviously, showing that there hasn't been much change at all, and that people still live like this in our contemporary society. I believe the biggest importance about Gene Toomer in this piece of writing is that it relates a lot to contemporary black society, a lot more than what people expected back then. It was truly ahead of its time in which Toomer used the flexibility of lyricism to portray the enchanting rhythm and flow that black writers and artists use to express today. In Song of a Son, Gene really shows his ass in lyrical capability. This poem is arguably Toomer's most famous written piece. The content of this poem hints at the differences in folk culture from the then pre-Harlem Renaissance era. Assuming that the voice in this poem is coming from someone who is mourning over the past changes that have come, directly acknowledging the people who have come from enslavement. Here I will read an excerpt. Oh, Negro slaves, dark purple, ripened plums, squeezed and bursting in the pinewood air, passing before they stripped the old tree bare, one plum was saved from me. One seed becomes an everlasting song, a singing tree, caroling softly souls of slavery. They were, and that they are to me, caroling softly souls of slavery. Here, I believe Gene is nodding to enslaved people who struggled before him, in which their struggles were not in vain. Specifically, the mentioned plum was saved for me. I believe this is Toomer acknowledging the small portions of food that could have been passed down to the young, while alluding to the metaphorical. The enslaved people didn't have much to their next of kin, or to their family after emancipation, though afterwards, the black people that made the most of what they had. Sprouting whole trees, giving them to at least flourish in their expression through song and lyricism. Unknowingly, Toomer predicted the way that our artists today would go on to project their sorrow, suffering, and even success, ultimately reaping the seeds of their ancestors to bloom through the expression of song, dance, and writing. Now, in our contemporary time, we have a plethora and abundance of creative people who have attained their success through true emotional expression of their blackness alone. However, such critics like Barbara Foley of Rutgers University call out Toomer for his fetishization of labor processes, in which her opinion of Cain is a lot of ridicule, acknowledging that Gene upholds a lot of conditions that the Southern cotton workers endured in their everyday lives, which of course is pretty obvious in my opinion. Black people across the South and the West didn't have real good working conditions, nor good living conditions. Black society at the time was numb to the burden of their experience and just saw it as is, something that they would have to deal with for a while, and of course, actively finding hope and optimism along the way. This is where I believe writers like Gene are very important because they acknowledge the beauty and the suffering. They make something that is artistically intelligent while not leaving out the people that endured the pain of slavery. It is fair to say that most historians or critics are hesitant to give Toomer his credit in setting the stones for many famous black artists today. But besides his ideologies, he found it in himself to use his blackness to reap his own seeds to obtain his own success. It seems to me that throughout Cain, Toomer has found a walkable line of history and artistic representation. Overall, I can appreciate Cain more than most critics because it highlights a realism of the conditions that most black people live through, while still being able to create something beautiful out of it. There is true art that can be found within the painful experiences that occurred during the Jim Crow era and the plantation and slavery era. I believe that Gene Toomer effectively finds a middle ground between the polar opposite societies of black and white America, and this exemplifies the both of them while acknowledging the foul acts of humanity like lynching, blatant racism, and the many attempts of cultural suppression on black people.